Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Zaiba Kara, a senior trainer at IMA Dubai. And I welcome everyone to the webinar on chemical peels today. Let's talk about the learning objectives today. So today we're gonna learn about three main things in chemical peels. First is the basic principles of chemical peels. Second, we would discuss about types of chemical peels. And then third, we would discuss about the pre and post considerations for chemical peels. So they did a survey, and the American Society of Plastic Surgery, they did a statistics and in 2019, and they came up with the five topmost minimally invasive procedures in 2019. And as you can see from the chart, chemical peels still would be at, you know, the third most performed minimally invasive procedures still in 2019. Because, you know, nowadays everybody prefers lasers and more light-based procedures and radio frequency. So we think that chemical peels have no role in today's world. But no, that's not the fact. If you see on the screen, you have the botulinum toxin type A, which is Botox, at 4%. Then you have your soft tissue fillers at 2.7 million. Then you have your chemical peels, which is at 1.3 million. And then of course your laser hair reduction at 1 million. And then your intense pulse light at 685.755. So chemical peels still plays a very, very important role when you're having your aesthetic practice, because it is very, very, you know, convenient, very cost effective, and also having less downtime depending on the, you know, complaint basically. So that's why chemical peels still play a very important role. So of course chemical peels are not very, very you know, new. They have been practiced since the ancient Egyptian times. If you see Queen Cleopatra in 69 to 30 BC before Christ, she used to bathe in sour milk. And what does this sour milk contain? Is basically it contains lactic acid, and that's why so sour milk basically contains lactic acid. And as you know, lactic acid is, it has amazing bleaching properties. It gives your skin that you know, glow, and you know, it actually doesn't peel. So it's a very beautiful acid, very gentle on the skin as well. And they also use this alabaster to improve the skin texture basically. And then ancient Greek and Roman physicians also used sour milk, grape juice and lemon extracts for rejuvenation. So as you know, sour milk, you have lactic acid, grape juice, you have tartaric acid, and lemon extracts, you know, vitamin C for skin rejuvenation. Moving further, the modern history of chemical peels, if you go to see in the year 1882, Professor P.G. Unna, he's a German dermat, prescribed the use of salicylic acid, resorcinol, phenol, and TCA, which is trichloroacetic acid, for chemical peeling. Then in the early 1960s, Thomas Baker and Howard Gordon modified the phenol peel and set the standard of deep chemical peels, still in use to this day. So we are using a lot of Baker Gordon phenol peel, which you call it, but these are kind of deeper peels, so not many people are using it, and it has to be like the specialized training has to be taken, you know, has to be undergone to do the phenol peel, and a special setup definitely. It can be done in an office clinic setup. Then in the 1990s, Zain Obagi, who's a US dermat, he first published a standardized TCA-based peel called as the Obagi Blue Peel, okay, which is still being practiced. It's amazing, but definitely it has downtime peeling and all of that. So what exactly, you know, whenever you do a procedure, it has to be, there's an objective, there's a pathology on how it works. So how does the chemical peel work? So to cause destruction of the skin at the required depth, to treat a certain pathology without causing any scarring. So that's our objective of chemical peel. like for laser hair reduction, if you say, so in laser hair reduction, we want to destroy the target without causing any harm to the surrounding structures, right? So likewise, chemical peels, we have to destroy the skin at a certain depth where your pathology is. For example, if you have something very superficial, like just like a, you know, tan, or maybe like just like freckles, something which is very superficial, you need something which is like, you know, superficially damaging it, and we're not going very deep to other structures and harming them, and without causing any scarring. So you have to always remember, in order to not scar the patient, you have to learn in depth about the anatomy, you know, and physiology of the skin. Basically, very, very important. So you know where exactly your pathology lies, and what exact treatment you should be doing. Because some, like supposedly, if you have an acne scar, definitely peeling would not help for an acne scar. You'll require some deeper technologies, like your lasers, resurfacing lasers, or deeper peels. So that's very important. Let me double check if some, I hope everyone can see my screen. So I'm going to continue. Okay, so this was about the objective of chemical peels. Now, what's the mechanism of action? As we know, every peel or every procedure which we perform works on a mechanism, okay? So likewise, chemical peels, also we call it as chemo exfoliation. It basically works on the principle of controlled wounding, you know? So like you are injuring your skin. What happens when you fall down? You injure your skin, you have inflammation for a couple of days, then the wound bed starts healing, there is re-epithelialization, and then the scab, and then the scab falls off. So that's what exactly is happening when you're doing a chemical peel. So basically, the chemical peel causes blistering effect on the skin, allowing exfoliation of the outer layers. So basically, our outer layers would be like mostly the stratum corneum, which we want to slog off. Okay, then the wound healing reaction, this all of this gives, any kind of injury gives rise to the wound healing reaction, okay? Which again, in a couple of days, it synthesizes new elastin collagen and GAG, which is the glucose aminoglycans, via the activation of the inflammatory mediators. So this is exactly, I mean, that's what a wound healing response is. This is what it looks like. So when you have an injury, you have inflammation, okay, where you have the degradation of the ECM, and in the first 6 to 8 hours and up to 10 days, you have this process going on, and then there's vascular response and cellular response, okay, and the growth factors and cytokines involved here would be the TGF-beta, the PDGF, the EGF, the EGF, FGF, and interleukin-1, and then for the next 30 days, okay, mostly starts at 5 to 30 days, you have your wound closure, you have your re-epithelialization, your angiogenesis, means your blood circulation is achieved over there, in the wound area, and the ECM formation as well. And then you have your your collagen formation starts from day 30 and lasts for around 300 days. So that's around a year. That's long. I mean, you keep on making new elastin collagen until 300 days, okay? And this remodeling, dermal remodeling, takes place in the presence of the growth factors like TGF-beta, FGF, TIMPs, and MMPs. This exactly is your wound healing response, okay? So let's talk about like where you could place your chemical peels, in terms of when you compare them with ablative, non-ablative, and resurfacing devices. So when we talk about superficial skin peels, we are, being very, very superficial, just in the epidermis, So even epidermis, we'll read through in the following slides. What are superficial skin peels? How deep do they penetrate? What is the exact depth? Okay. So you place your superficial skin peels exactly like microneedling and mesotherapy. Then comes your non-ablative photo rejuvenation, like what you do with your IPLs. Okay, even kind of a hair reduction is a kind of a non-ablative photo rejuvenation, you could say. Then you have your medium depth peels, which could be placed in the category of the fractional ablative laser resurfacing. So you have your erbium YAG lasers, your CO2 lasers, which are in the fractional mode. You put your medium depth peels there. Then if you consider your deep phenol peels, which are not very aggressively practiced by everyone because it requires special settings, special training. And so that's why it's like you're doing a full laser resurfacing, like with the carbon dioxide and the erbium lasers. There you place your deep phenol peels. The results are phenomenal with the deep phenol peels. But the only thing is you cannot, you have to choose your patient very, very wisely. You can never do deep phenol peels on darker skin dyes because it has like a long downtime and then redness and chances of post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. So there are a lot of things which you have to keep in mind for deep phenol peels. Next, why are chemical peels so popular still? You know, it's very, as I said in the beginning, they're very effective. They're very, very easy to perform. There's no much of cost involved. Like, you know, when you have a laser machine, like you can just open a clinic and start practicing your chemical peels, you know, just buy the product and just get the basic accessories of the chemical peels, like bowls, brushes, and all of those. And then you can basically start doing chemical peels. And of course, chemical peels, it's used for a lot of things, like, you know, your acne, active acne, for your pigmentation, or just for rejuvenation. And so that's why it still plays a very, very important role in today's aesthetic practice. It's very, very easy to perform. So it's not like a rocket science. You don't have any parameters to learn. But yeah, you have to be very careful. Some peels are time dependent. Some peels are layer dependent. So if you're a beginner, like go through a proper, thorough, training, which will prepare you for the, for the chemical peels, how is it done, which peels are indicated for what indications and all of that. And then you will definitely not go wrong. Okay. And definitely peels can be customized according to the indication and skin type. Okay. And it's useful in improving skin quality and treating signs of aging. I have a few messages coming in. I hope you can see my screen. Can somebody tell me? Is my screen visible and am I like audible? Perfect. Thank you. I'll continue. Okay. So it's useful in improving the skin quality and treating the signs of aging, pigmentation, superficial and deep pigmentation also with some peels. Scars to a certain extent, maybe post-inflammatory hyperpigmented scars, you can say, but not definitely atrophic scars. Okay, so atrophic scars require a little bit of aggressive treatment with more, resurfacing and all of this, and ablative and non-ablative lasers, and some precancerous lesions as well. And again, as I said, minimal financial outlay as opposed to energy-based devices. So there's not much of investment involved on the initial stages. You can just open a clinic and you can start with your peels. Meanwhile, you're getting prepared to get your machinery. You can always start with your peels and mesotherapy and PRP. These are like procedures which are not of a big investment. Okay. So that's why peels remain still a very integral part of aesthetic practice. Then what are the indications of chemical peels? Definitely, as I said, it has a lot of indications, but it does require a couple of sessions. It doesn't happen in one or two sessions. But yeah, so these are the host of indications which you can use your peels for. Talking about pigmentary disorders, you can use it for solar lentigens, for ephelides, for melasma, PIH. Okay, ephelides are, pigmentation. Inflammatory disorders like acne, active acne, basically. Then you have your rosacea, you can use it for then scarring, acne scarring, surgical scarring. Again, when you say scarring, you think about deeper peels and energy-based devices, light and non-ablative and ablative. Then chrono aging, definitely your photo aging for your lines and wrinkles, which are superficial and medium depth, and your precancerous lesions like the actinic keratosis. So these are the host of things which you can treat, you know, and these are the very common things which you start seeing in your practice initially. And peels would do wonders, you know, if you're using the right peel, you know your diagnosis, you know where the pathology is, you will never go wrong with peels. So there's a classification. It's categorized into, depending on the depth of penetration into the skin, the peels are being classified into very superficial, superficial, medium depth, and deep peels. Basically, the depth of peel is determined by the depth of pathology being treated, okay? So that's very important for you to know, guys. First and foremost, when the patient walks in, you need to first have a very, very good and a thorough consultation with the client so as to know what exactly is her concern, okay, or her disease. You diagnose it, then you determine the skin type, and then you decide what kind of treatment you're going to do. I'm talking in general, not only with peels, but any other aesthetic procedures as well. Then the next important thing is setting the expectations right. So that's very, very important. When you talk to the client or your patient, you have to set the expectation right, you know. They should know what exactly they'll see after one session or after a couple of sessions, how many sessions are involved, because of course there's a monetary commitment as well, which is involved, and they need to plan their finances, they need to plan their budget as well. That's one thing. And for example, you have a patient of melasma, you know, she's done host of treatments and then she's come to you. And she's like, you know, it just doesn't go. It just basically just stays there. When I do the treatment, it's good. And then when melasma is a chronic disease. It's going to be there. It's just like diabetes, you know. It's not going to go anywhere. But if you do a couple of treatments with peels or light-based devices, you can keep it under control. But it can never go 100%. So as a practitioner, you should know that. So you will be able to convey this to your client that this is a chronic disease. So you have to mentally prepare him or her that this is a chronic disease and this is what we can do with it. And this is how we can maintain it. And she needs to come for maintenance sessions on and off. So this is very important. So diagnosing the pathology basically, and then taking the client into confidence and setting the expectations right. This is your responsibility before starting any kind of procedure. So this is our your skin structure. Basically, when you look under a microscope, microscopically you see the stratum corneum, which is the most superficial layer. Then you have stratum lucidum, which is only present in the palms and soles. Then you have stratum granulosum, stratum spinosum, and stratum basalis. Okay, so talking about very superficial peels. Okay, so when you have very superficial peels, they penetrate only up till the stratum corneum, which would be 0.004 millimeters in depth. Okay, then you have your superficial peels next to very superficial peels. They penetrate to a depth of around 0.06 millimeters. And then you have your medium depth peels, which penetrate around 0.45 to 0.60 millimeters in depth. And they penetrate up till the papillary dermis. Okay. Then you have your deep peels, which go up till the reticular dermis, and they're around 0.60 to 0.80 in millimeters in depth. Okay. The deeper the peel, the greater efficacy, but the greater the risk. Okay. Remember this. So as you move on from the very superficial to the deep peels, of course, the results are going to be amazing, going to be very, very efficacious. But at the same time, the risks involved are high. You can burn the patient, you can scar the patient, You can give a patient a the patient a temporary basically transient PIH, post inflammatory hyperpigmentation. So these are the risks involved. So depending on the condition, you always choose your I've been repeating this. So depending on your pathology, which area, if your pathology is in the epidermis, so you can definitely treat it with superficial peels like the acne. If you have something deeper, like deep lines and wrinkles, definitely you need to jump to a medium depth peel, which goes until the papillary dermis. But then we talk in, further down the lecture that how you can avoid complications and how will you prepare the patient's skin before doing peel so that you can avoid any kind of risks involved. So depth of chemical peel definitely depends on the chemical applied. Okay, because various chemicals have different mode of action. The concentration of the chemical peel, the skin type, basically how thick or thin the skin is, the preparation of the skin, and the technique of application. Okay, so we will talk about it. What is the effect of skin thickness, basically? So when you have thicker skin, like especially men, they really have thick skin. So in this case, you will require more coats of the peel to reach the depth, okay? Because this thicker skin has greater number of adnexial structures. Basically, adnexial structures, they are the one which determine skin regeneration. So in thicker skin, you have more adnexial structures, and that's why it will require more coats to reach a certain depth compared to a thin skin. In thin skin, you have poor adnexial structure and less number of coats are required. Next, basically your main basic pre-procedural consideration for chemical peels would be patient evaluation. As I said, when the patient comes to your clinic, you have to sit with the patient, give her some time, let her talk about her complaint or concern. Basically, has she taken any treatment? Has she undergone any kind of procedures for it? How long has the disease been there? And what home care is she using? Then what is her expectation? And all of those that needs to be evaluated. And you should give a little bit time for the consultation, a thorough consultation. Then patient education and informed consent. As I said, you explain what exactly is going to happen, what kind of treatment have you chosen, and what will be the effect of the treatment, what is the pathology of the case, basically, what's the pathology of the disease, is it completely curable, or you can, give her like what kind of results, always give them a percentage, it's very important. So you have to let your patient know what exactly you're doing and how many sessions are required and all of that. Next important thing is the informed consent. Very, very important for your safety as well as your patient's safety to have a consent form. A consent form should always state the procedure, what exactly it is, the do's and don'ts, okay, and what could be the risk involved and the expected result, okay. All this should be there, and you have to make sure that the patient has understood each and everything, and then you take a signature and keep it safely for you. In future, if anything happens, it's always safe to present the consent form. Then baseline photographs. This is a very, very important thing, guys. So when you have patients with, in aesthetics, you should always take photographs. Remember to take photographs from the same angle, in the same room, possibly with the white background or a plain background with, you can actually see the entire, face. And you change the profile sideways, and then the front view, and all of that. So photographs are very important to, when the patient comes, and she says, "Oh, I have no results." That's the time you take the later photograph after the procedure, and then you show her the results. And sometimes it's very funny that they really get surprised, like, "Oh, really, doctor? When I see the photographs, there are results," because they see themselves every day. It's not very noticeable that something's happened. So very important photograph. Then priming of the skin. Priming basically is just like when you are doing your, painting your walls, you're putting a priming agent. Priming agent is something which is going to make sure that your color on the wall fits in properly, blends in well, falls properly and is smooth. So something like it. you have to prime or prepare the skin for chemical peel. And how do you do this is with some, basically you use some creams and you prime your skin. What the priming does is basically increases your cell turnover, okay, and then prepares your skin for the peel. And when you prime the skin, you've got rid of your dead skin cells as well. And that's why your peel penetration will be very uniform as well. Okay, then you have your procedure and selection of the appropriate peel. Depending on your pathology, basically you will select what kind of peel. So if it's pigmentation, you go for your trichloroacetic acid, your tranexamic acid, and all of those. And if you have something like acne, you would definitely use azelaic acid, your salicylic acid, and different kind of concentrations. You can always start with lower concentrations and you can build up gradually. Do not be very over enthusiastic from the very first session, I know my peels very well. Let me go with the, 30 or 40% salicylic acid and let me just give the results in one session. No, that's not wise to do. So always try to build up slowly. Okay, do not be over enthusiastic. Okay, and if you're not sure, always check with your seniors, read about it, take opinion, discuss. Okay, that will really help. Then aftercare plays a very, very important role, basically, because, as you've peeled, you have the new skin, fresh skin, which is there. And this skin will have, it can be prone to a lot of hyperpigmentation if you've not, prescribed them the right products. So sunblock plays a very, very important role in any kind of, even priming the skin. Priming agents, one of the priming agents is a sunblock as well. Okay, so aftercare will definitely be a sunblock. Then depending on the complaint, if it's acne, you give them some antibiotic with some retinols. Then if it's the anti-aging, again, retinols. If it's pigmentation, you give them Kligman's formula or some hydroquinone, depending, or just some melanin tyrosinase inhibitors, something like that. So aftercare plays a very important role. It's not that you just do one or two sessions and that's it. The thing is better and you stop doing anything. No, aftercare plays a very, very important. It's like a synergistic effect, your treatment at the clinic and the aftercare as well. Then maintenance of results is very important. And that's depending on your and the patient's, the patient has to be very compliant with what you have told. It's very difficult, but yeah, as long as they are compliant to a certain extent, they can maintain the results. Okay, you have to do repeat sessions. You have to do. You have to take your aftercare very seriously. Exposure to the sun should be minimized, and all of this. Then you should always know that how to deal with complications. Definitely, even if you're an expert, you can always go wrong. So, but you should know exactly where you've gone wrong and how would you correct it, basically. So you will know how to deal with the complications. Now, priming for chemical peels, basically, priming is essential typically for 2 weeks prior to the peel. So it can be anywhere between 2 to 4 weeks, ideally. And definitely you have to stop. Now, what are the priming agents? You can say priming agents would be anything which will increase the cell turnover, remove your dead damaged skin, and prepare your skin for the peel. So anything like hydroquinone, basically. You can use your triple combination, which is the Kligman's. You can also use other combination peels like Cosmilan, Dermamilan, Home Care to prepare the skin. Then sunblock plays a very important role, and retinol, a basic retinol, or like in UAE you have Ecritin. We can give them like a 0.025 or a 0.05 Ecritin to prepare or prime the skin along with the good sunblock. And these priming agents, very, very important, should be stopped 3 to 5 days prior to the peel. Because, these priming agents are going to make your skin flake. And while your skin is flaking, you do not want to add on to the burden and put another peel. So you need to stop the priming agent 3 to 5 days prior to the peel. And sunblock will be continued all the time. Then what will be the priming agents would be sunscreen, as I said, topical retinoids, your alpha hydroxy acid. Yes, this is very important as well. You know, like you can give them creams containing lactic acid, glycolic acid, very, very lesser percentage, which is just, you know, priming the skin. Depigmenting agents like arbutin, kojic acid, hydroquinone, all of these would be tyrosinase inhibitors. And also priming will help in preventing post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. So priming will help in, you know, basically preparing the skin, increases the cell turnover, prevents post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. Then makes the peel penetration uniform. So these are all the advantages of priming the skin prior to any kind of chemical peels. So ensures uniform peel penetration, reduces recovery time, decreases risk of side effects, and enforces patient compliance. So at this time, you'll also know that how is your patient, behavior, like is she or he compliant with what you're giving them or no. So that's very important. Okay. Before the peel procedure, what do? Is we cleanse your skin properly with an antiseptic cleanse, basically, and we degrease your skin with acetone. As you know, we have a natural moisturizing factor, which is the sebum, basically, which is very, very less secreted in a very less quantity, but that keeps our skin, you know, moist and doesn't allow transepidermal water loss. But we need to get rid of this oil layer before doing any peel so that we have a better penetration of the peel. So we degrease with the normal medical grade acetone. Now, peel procedure, application of peeling agent. How will you apply the peeling agent? Okay, you can always use whatever you like, but you can use cotton tips, you can use a ball of cotton, you can use a gauze, which is, you know, rough, or a brush. So basically, when you have cotton tips, it's like Q-tips, which you clean your ears with, earbuds. Basically, these two Q-tips you can use and dip it in the peel and then use it all across your face, go around your face. The advantage of this is there's mechanical exfoliation which is happening because of the rough cotton. Okay, same happens with the gauze as well. Okay, there's mechanical exfoliation. So you're mechanically removing the dead skin and then the peel is penetrating uniformly and much better. And then you have the brush also. Always try to use a fan brush, okay, so that you do not, you know, do not have too much of product in your brush. If your brush is like a bunched one, a lot of hair in one area, the brush, hair brush basically, so that will deposit more peel in the area and that could cause some burn. So always use a fan brush, okay, get rid of the excess by tapping it on the bowl, basically your glass bowl, okay. And then know your peel, that's very important. You have to know your peel exactly. What peel is it? How long can I use it for? Like for a particular skin type, how long can I leave it for? And what would be the side effects? And what are the pathologies or clinical conditions it's targeting? You know, so that's very important. Standardize the peeling procedure. Very important. Standardize and follow the same protocol every time. Even application is very important as well. It's not that, you know, in some area you're depositing a lot of, the peel product and the other areas you're just leaving it or just going one. So you have to be having an even application. Caution, very important. Do not overcoat. Okay, you think, that's why I said less enthusiastic. Initially, you start with one coat and then gradually build up to two or three, depending on the client's concern. Okay, and be very careful with glycolic acid. Since glycolic acid is a time-dependent peel. So, for example, the whole glycolic acid should be applied on the face within a span of 30 seconds, okay, to the whole face, okay? And then you put on your timer so that you don't go wrong. You know, glycolic acid should be left between 3 to 5 minutes, and that's the maximum, okay? And you do not want to see any kind of frosting while you're doing glycolic acid. So glycolic acid, you have to be really, really careful. Otherwise, you can burn. So some are time dependent and some are coat dependent. So we'll discuss about it in later. Now, these are the basic equipments you require. So always set up your trolley beforehand. Okay, you have a trolley set up for peels, which will definitely in the picture, as you can see, you have some cotton buds, you have some dropper, you have some water for flushing the eyes in case you, accidentally, pour the peel in the patient's eyes, which should not be the case. Always hold it away, always hold the bowl away from the patient's eyes, a timer, acetone basically for degreasing, a neutralizer or water, some cotton swabs, some cotton buds, on all this on a trolley to be handy, okay? And Vaseline, guys. Don't forget, Vaseline plays a very important role. So this basically is used to, coat the mucous membranes on the face, like your outer canthus, that's the outer side of your eyes, which has a crease. Then the nasolabial, okay, both sides of the alar, okay, crease, which we call, and then also your mouth, both the sides of your mouth, the outside, okay. This is very, very important because the crease, you might accidentally deposit more amount of peel in these areas, and this would lead to a burn. So you have to coat them with Vaseline, very important, okay. So any peeling solution, you can use a cotton bud, gauze, or brush, as I said. But again, pressure is very, very important. If you put a lot of pressure, you will end up, having the penetration more. So apply a gentle uniform pressure. That would be my advice, a gentle uniform pressure. You don't want to press too hard unless you really want to go very deep. Do not press too hard. Do not pressurize too much. Otherwise it will increase the depth of penetration. So I'm getting, I think, a lot of questions which we are going to discuss after the lecture. So keep your questions for the end so we can just discuss it once and for all. Okay. Now, there's something known as feathering. Usually, this is for medium depth and deep peels, deep peels. So if you're considering to do the face and, just the face, you might, once the peeling is over, your face, the skin on the face might look totally different than the neck. So it's always advised that you go a few inches below, okay, like the jawline. Like you can go to the submental area and do a little bit of feathering just to have the kind of a camouflage effect, So that's known as feathering, okay, it prevents a line of demarcation, okay. Then let's talk about classification of peels. So as we said, there are superficial peels. And again, superficial, we can have it as a single acid, or we can also have a few acids combined and they act as a superficial peel. So your single acid peels would be the TCA, between 10 to 25% would be considered as a single acid peel. Your 20 to 70% glycolic acid would be considered again as a single acid peel. Your 10 to 30% salicylic acid would also be considered as a superficial peel. Then you can also move on to combination peels. Like when you have combination peels, you're doing multiple things at one time, like you're combining your, supposedly your Jesner's. You have your 14% resorcinol, you have your 14% lactic acid, and you have your 14% salicylic acid. This is the original Jesner solution, okay? This is basically, of course, treating your acne. Resorcinol is also doing your, working for your lines and wrinkles, and lactic acid is giving the evenness and also works for pigmentation. So, when you have a combination peel, it's working for at different levels. Then you have your acne masks, okay, like which have 30% salicylic acid, 3% retinoic acid. Again, it's doing a lot of, cell turnover, increasing the cell turnover, and salicylic acid, as you know, it's anti-inflammatory, it's, keratolytic, okay, and it lipolysis, basically. It also basically cuts your fats, basically. Then you have your salicylic acid 20% as a beta hydroxy acid. And then you also have some peels with 10% TCA and 10% retinoic acid. So these are combination peels. So this is the application of phenol peel, what I was talking about. To avoid the line of demarcation, you go a little bit lower to the mandible where the patient, when let her sit down, mark below the mandible, and that's where exactly you will go until. Okay. Talking about superficial peels, which are the alpha hydroxy acid. The glycolic acid, which is the most commonly used alpha hydroxy acid nowadays, and around 30 to 70% glycolic acid, depending on the pH, okay, we are going to use the glycolic acid. So normally available in the market now is 2 to 3.5, which are being commonly used. Okay. So always remember, glycolic acid is time dependent. That means once you apply the peel, you have to put on the timer and keep it for 3 to 5 minutes, depending on the skin type again. Okay. And the endpoint here means every peel procedure has an endpoint. Like for salicylic acid, it's pseudo frosting. Okay. And it's self-neutralizing. For TCA, it's true frosting. You'll see white spots. We have some pictures we'll show you. And glycolic acid will give you a little erythema. Either it can be a little bit here and there, or it can be widespread. But whatever, you have to neutralize glycolic acid. Okay. You do not keep it more than 5 minutes for sure. So neutralization can be done with 1% sodium bicarbonate or plain water. You can neutralize the glycolic acid. And treatment interval would be between 2 to 3 weeks. Then you have your salicylic acid solutions, which you can start from 20 to 30%. Even you have 10, 15, 20, 30, 40, okay, and which is suspended. Salicylic acid basically are crystals, and salicylic acid is suspended in ethanol, which is alcohol, and propylene glycol. And definitely this is toxic, so that's why salicylic acid is not if it has systemic absorption, it cannot be used for bigger areas. Like, you cannot do salicylic acid for the full back, full chest. No, you can do it for the full face definitely. But if you want, if they have back acne, you can do it as like a spot treatment. Then, because it has a lot of toxic effects, like salicylism, you call it a salicylism. There's increased, heartbeat. There's nausea. There's vomiting, and all of those. And it can also lead to cardiac arrest. So you have to be very careful. Then it is keratolytic. Okay, leading to superficial desquamation, as I said. It just removes only dead damaged skin. Lipophilic, so reaches the sebaceous glands and gets out all the oil and shrinks them. Decreases sebum secretion, okay, and also evaporates, leaving a white precipitate. So basically, salicylic acid are white crystals. And as you know, it's suspended in alcohol for stability. So when the alcohol evaporates, you can also see the salicylic acid crystals which are there on your skin. And this is looks like frosting, but it's known as pseudo or false frosting. This is not true frosting. And it's self-neutralizing. You can keep it if you want it, but it's better to remove it with water because that white specks doesn't look nice. So you can just clean it and then apply some moisturizer and sunblock to end up the peel. So moisturizer and sunblock is a must at end of every peel. Every 2 weeks, depending on the patient's concern, like you can do it every 2 weeks if it's acne. Okay. And these are some results with salicylic acid. Of course, it doesn't happen in one session. It requires a couple of sessions. Then talking about trichloroacetic acid. This is also sold as white crystals diluted in water to obtain solutions of different strengths. Okay, TCA, you have again different strengths available. This is non-toxic and non-allergenic, and you can do for bigger areas. Basically, it's amazingly, it works amazingly well for pigmentation, for evening out the skin tone, photo aging, and lines and wrinkles. And if you go for the deeper, the higher concentrations, like 100%, you can use it as a cross technique for acne scars, like completely ablate. It acts as an ablative kind of a thing. So then a year, it does not penetrate into dermal blood vessels and hence has no systemic spread, unlike the salicylic acid. Penetration here is depending on the concentration and the coat of acid applied and the extent of rubbing. So you have to be careful. You gradually build up. Somebody, with a skin of color or a darker skin, Fitzpatrick skin type 4, 5, 6 is where you have to be very, very careful. Less, less is always more in such cases, basically. So you start applying one coat and you gradually build up to the second and the third. Okay. Slowly, slowly. And always stick to what your basically manufacturers are saying. Go through a thorough basically training with them about their products. And you should know the do's and don'ts, because every product sometimes has a different protocol, basically. And nowadays you have a lot of, you can also have it in the crude form, like just a TCA bottle, or sometimes it comes like a kit. It has like a a cleansing thing, then you have the pre peel solution, then the peel itself, and the post care, all of that. So always go through a thorough training with your manufacturer, I mean, in whatever case, whatever peel you're buying. Then you have to neutralize it with water, and it gets neutralized by, TCA as well is a self-neutralizing thing. Once it reaches a certain depth, the action really stops. It doesn't go beyond that. But in TCA, you see these white color spots, which is the true frosting. And that appears because of the denaturation of the proteins in this case. So TCA is around 10 to 25% would be considered as superficial peels, and around 35% would be considered as a medium depth, and 50 to 100 would be considered as deep peels. So this is what exactly I was talking about. These are the three levels of frosting which you can see. In the first picture, you see like, you know, here and there, frosting which is here and there, which is right reticular frost with background erythema. You can see a little erythema on the forehead with, you know, frosting effects here and there. Next picture, you can see a confluent light white with background erythema. You can see like confluent, light white frosting, and also you can see erythema. And in the third picture, this is what is a solid white frosting without erythema. So remember, everyone, that, you know, of course, frosting is a very, very good indication, but, you know, these areas would get darker and then peel off. So you have to prepare your patient, mentally, that these areas will look darker and then gradually peel off. So this is very important for you to let the patient know. Okay. And if you see the third solid white frosting, it is really, really intense. So the patient will look really, really, dark and like a plastic-like appearance for a couple of days, and then it starts peeling off. Okay. So as I said, frosting is a consequence of protein coagulation of epidermal and dermal proteins by trichloroacetic acid. So it is amazing peel. TCA, I personally love TCA. This is with 15% TCA. As you can see, she has a lot of photo aging, photo damage, basically a lot of freckles. And within two sessions of TCA, this is what her skin looked like. It's so nice and taut. It's glowy because it's reflecting the light. And, the pigmentation is so much better compared to her previous picture. This is TCA for the back, as you can see. And as I said, it's TCA is quite safe to use for a lot of bigger areas. You can safely use it, okay, without having any systemic complications, unlike the salicylic acid. And this is again TCA with retinoic acid for your knuckle area. Very safe. Okay. And then the Jessner's peel. Now, Jessner's peel is a combination peel. You have resorcinol, salicylic acid, and lactic acid. And you have these are suspended in absolute alcohol. Okay, this is basically formulated to limit the absorption of resorcinol and increase keratolysis. So they all three ingredients are complementing each other, and they work in have a synergistic effect, and they work for a lot of things like pigmentation, for lines and wrinkles, photo aging, and all of that. And I mean acne as well. Then talking about medium depth peels, you have single acid peels like 35 and 40% TCA, and then you have combination peels. Yeah, like 35% TCA with 70% of glycolic acid, Jessner's plus 35% TCA. Now, these are like really strong peels. 10% phenol plus 20% TCA, which is a medium to deep self-neutralizing peel to treat moderate to severe aging and acne scars. So medium depth peel, anywhere, as we said, you saw where it goes. So we would like to consider something which is more deeper, like deep lines and wrinkles, deeper pigmentations, okay? And you have to be very careful while doing medium depth peels on darker skin types. Always be very, very careful, okay? Because there's a high risk of post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation with the Fitzpatrick skin type 4, 5, and 6. Always, if you're in doubt, do a test patch, guys. Do not let that chance go. You know, do a test patch. What's the harm? Do a small test patch. Wait for a couple of days. See what the reaction is. Then it's easier for you to, you know, take the step. So unless, I mean, like, doing the whole face and then, you know, spoiling the case, it's better to do a small test patch and then take it from there. This is what it looks like with a combination peel of retinoic acid, salicylic acid, and phenol. This was a lovely peel. We had it back then. I have used this peel personally for myself, for my back acne, and it was amazing. It's the perfect peel. We do not have it anymore in the UAE, but it was an amazing peel. It has phenol, glutathione. You can Google it. It's a lovely peel, basically. It peels out and makes your skin nice and tight, and also pigmentation works very well. This is again with the salicylic acid, phenol, and retinoic acid, the same perfect peel I'm talking about. Then talking about deep peels, we have your Baker Gordon phenol peel, and you have your TCA, 50% and more than 50%. These would be considered as deep chemical peels. Your phenol peel is basically more for, your aging, really, really deep. So look at the results. It's just commendable, but you have to choose, as I said, your patients very, very wisely. You can only choose middle-aged, fair-skinned women with blue eyes, blonde hair, okay, that kind of a, female who does not expose herself to the sun and all of those. Lighter skin types, like 1, 2, and 3 maximum, okay? But as I said, phenol peel requires a lot of training. Secondly, it requires a particular setup because you need to, do it under sedation. It's really, really painful for the patient. You have to monitor the vitals. You have to keep on hydrating the patient while she is on the peels and all, peel on and all that. It's a different ball game altogether. Then, 69-year-old dark-skinned woman who has done a phenol peel 1 year after the deep peeling. It's just phenomenal. The results are amazing, but we do not do it in this region, so I have no, basically any experience with this kind of peel. But yeah, we read a lot about it, and we see a lot of pictures and researches. This is, again, 69-year-old, not dark-skinned, she's light-skinned, but she has, of course, yeah, a lot of freckles and photo aging, basically. But look at the results. It's like 30 years younger. What else do you want? It's amazing. Now, what would be the pre-peel considerations? Okay. So your pre-peel considerations before a month, as I said, would definitely be your priming the skin, okay, your sunscreen, your alpha hydroxy acids, your retinoic acids, okay, your tyrosinase inhibitors, like you're suppressing your melanin pigments, basically, with your Kojic, Arbutin, Kligman's formula would be your hydroquinone and tretinoin, okay? So all of this, and antiviral therapy. So yeah, some peels basically, like the deeper peels or the medium depth peels, could lead to a herpetic outbreak. So always take a history. If they have a history of two, episodes in a year, give them a prophylaxis. Your antiviral, always take a history of this, because I've heard with the medium depth peels and with combination peels, if they have a tendency of herpes, they do outbreak. So always take a consent and always take a history and give a prophylaxis. Then immediate pre-peel considerations definitely would be like washing the skin with soap, okay, and water, like a cleansing solution, disinfect with alcohol, and degrease with acetone to remove all the sebum and the oil so that the peel penetrates uniformly. Next, post-peel considerations would be definitely sun protection. Okay. Post-peel dermocosmeceuticals like gentle cleansers and moisturizers, very, very important to aid the skin in healing. Okay. And your topical steroids, you can give them to, some patients really respond very aggressively compared to the others. So you can give them steroids. If they have a lot of irritation and redness and they're very uncomfortable, so you can give them some steroids. Then topical depigmenting products to reduce the risk of pigmentation. Same, Kligman's formula, your Kojic, Arbutin, or your Dermamelan, Cosmelan, all of these, and no sun exposure at all. They have to, definitely stick to this. There should be no sun exposure. Otherwise, it will reverse the whole case. General concentration would be, they shouldn't, if you want to do especially medium depth or deep peels, they shouldn't have had raw Accutane or basically retin A within 6 months. Oral, I'm talking about. This is oral because many patients are under treatment for acne and they are on high doses of raw Accutane. So you do not do medium and deep peels with them for 6 months at least. What's on face? You do not do peels. Active herpes simplex, definitely you will not. Active herpes simplex or atopic dermatitis or psoriasis, you do not do peels for them in the active stage. Suspicious lesions, if you have any suspicious lesions, please consider doing a biopsy if you're not qualified enough. Like, you have to refer your case to your dermat or your plastic surgeon to exactly know what the cause is, and do not just blindly treat anything which you don't understand. So always refer the case and get the proper history, get the proper diagnosis, and then go ahead with the treatment. Active inflammation in the treatment area, definitely, if the treatment area does not look normal to you, is flaking, is irritated, is red, you do not go ahead with your peel. Skin is burning, scaling, or has incompletely healed from the previous peeling session, definitely you will not go ahead and do the second session. Okay, so you'll wait until your skin starts looking normal, is looking hydrated, nice, clean, and then you go ahead with your second session. If they have a history of keloids, you definitely do not do peels for them. In case you burn them or scar them, it might lead to a keloid. Okay, then you also consider some things like, you never do peels just before an important event. If they are getting married, in 3-4 days, definitely I would not recommend a peel, because it would lead to you never know, because already the bride or the person who's getting married is under so much stress, the skin might just respond in a different manner, so you never do anything. You should at least do it a month prior or 3 to 4 weeks prior in this case, or any case, like any party or something. You don't want to take the risk at the last moment. And then non-compliant patients. So patients with, who are not going to be compliant, like, they're going to expose themselves to the sun, they're not going to stick to your, home care routine, should not be, done. Patient with unrealistic expectations. So this is very important. As we said, in the first consultation itself, we are going to set the expectations of the patient that, from the first session, what you're going to see, second, third, fourth session, what exactly you're going to expect, and what would be the results expected. Then unrealistic goals. Yeah. Like, the peels definitely cannot change the pore diameter. Although pores may appear less pronounced transiently, but definitely it cannot change the pores. Cannot remove post-acne hypertrophic scars or keloids. They cannot, actually, peels are also not a facelift. And apart from deep peels such as phenol, it cannot work for sagging skin. Definitely not, Peels, as we said, unless you're doing a phenol peel, you cannot treat a sagging skin or a post-acne atrophic or hypertrophic scar with peels. You need to go for treatments with energy-based, lasers, devices, lasers, radio frequency plasma, and fractional lasers. What could be the complications of the peel? The common complications would be irritation, pruritus, which is itching, dryness, erythema, burning, and post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. These are the most common, complications which you can see. The uncommon ones would be any kind of allergy to the peeling agent, some kind of melia, acne flare-up sometimes happens, So you have to always inform the patient, take her into confidence that this could happen. These are very uncommon, but all this, mind you, should be in your, a consent form. Very, very important. Any kind of herpetic outbreak could take place, demarcation lines, hypertrophic scars, and keloids. This is what a post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation looks like. You should not see this, okay? That's why proper training is very, very important. Then treatment of complications. First and foremost, you do not panic. You should not panic if there's kind of a complication which is done. You should know how to handle it. So hand-holding, very, very important, is you take your patient into confidence and then treat her, give her some free sessions, give her some hydration, give her some post-care creams, and you have to do this, for free of cost. But do not get panicked and just proceed very calmly and in a scientific manner with your patient if you have complications. Then erythema, burning sensation, and edema. You can give them topical steroids, emollients, and sunscreen, basically. In trends in peeling nowadays, there are sequential peels, there are segmental peels, which are done for the perioral and periorbital rejuvenation. There's also lip augmentation and peels for the lips, and then a combination with energy. So very important in aesthetic practices to combine the energy-based devices with your peels to get much better results and faster results. And also punch blepharoplasty. Then what are sequential peels? So you can use 70% glycolic acid followed by 20% salicylic acid for mild acne twice a week for 3 months. And this, there was the research done, and this has also, it's as good as having an oral doxycycline for 3 months. So that's amazing, you know. When you can avoid oral, you know, medications, why not, you know, I mean, why not? Segmental peel here, you can treat each area with a different depth of peeling. Overall, quicker. So, like, supposedly, if you have the face, you don't have so much of damage around the face, but around her perioral area, she has a lot of deep lines and wrinkles. So you can treat this area with a different peel concentration or a different peel altogether, and the rest of the face with a different peel or a different peel concentration. Overall, quicker recovery is there. It's an office procedure. Definitely optimal results, and all only for non-synchronized aging. Okay. And these are segmental peels, which you can see. So we have done the spot treatment with the 50% TCA. 50% TCA is going to completely burn that skin, the solar lentigens, and peel it off. While rest of the area, we have applied a 15% TCA for general rejuvenation. As you can see, beautiful results. And that's about our chemical peels webinar. We are going to have a hands-on peels course in the month of April in IMA in April 2021. And also, like mesotherapy, as you know, we have an e-meso course. We're going to have an e-chemical peels course, which is definitely going to be coming up in the month of April. So if you would like to increase your knowledge more about peels, definitely you could join our courses and get more experience. Thank you so much. I hope it was informative. And now we can move on to the question answers, questions basically. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. It was a pleasure. So we do have a lot of questions already. Let me just scroll up. Somebody's asking, can we remove all melasma as well? No, we cannot remove all the melasma because, as we said, melasma is a chronic disease and it cannot be cured completely. So you have to use multiple modalities, different treatment methods to basically treat melasma and keep it under control, but it never goes 100%. Can we do peels in patient who has donated kidneys? Definitely you can do, but you have to be very, very careful. That's not a kidney, one kidney, right? Of course. So yeah, definitely you can do, but do not do salicylic acid for a bigger area. Just remember that if you're following all the norms and the contact time and neutralizing it in time, there should not be any problem. Yeah, probably we will mail you the recording of the webinar after the webinar. Acetone is not dangerous for the skin? No, not at all. Acetone is not at all dangerous. It's just going to be like, you're going to just take it on a cotton pad and quickly, like a toner, just, you know, go around it. So it's not dangerous. Is there any special acetone for the skin? No, it's just a normal acetone which we remove, which we, you know, remove our nail paint with. Is the same role of tranexamic acid in melasma and systemic conditions with contraindication? I mean, still tranexamic acid is being researched and studied a lot. Instead of peels, we are also having it systemically, tranexamic acid, and in the form of peels, and it's amazing. But when you're having it systemically, you have to be very careful. You have to do your blood tests and all. But as a peel, it's working very well, and also as a mesotherapy treatment, where you're injecting very, very little amount of tranexamic acid on the pigmented area. So yeah, it's working very well. Do peels have an expiry date? Yes, definitely peels have an expiry date. And in fact, once you open it, there's a certain you know, condition that you have. You can keep it for around a month, or you know 3 months or 6 months, depending on their you know, stability. Secondly, you have to keep it away from the sun, store it in cooler you know, areas of the clinic, basically. Yes. So what is the difference between peeling solution and gel based peel? So only like, there's no difference, basically. The concentration will be different, but gel-based are more, you can say, a little bit milder, like, you know, on the skin, you know. So gel-based would be much, it's good to have a gel-based peel. Which peel is good for blackheads, whiteheads, and milia? Will they go away after peeling? So melia definitely is does not go away after peeling. Melia, you need to automatic, I mean, basically make a nick in your skin with a small needle, and then you have to remove it. So it doesn't go with the peel. What is a party peel? Party peels basically would be comprising of lactic acids, like, you know, not much of salicylic acid, basically mild percentage of glycolic acid. These peeling agents like lactic, glycolic, kojic, arbutin, these do not peel, you know, but you have the flaking which goes unnoticed and gives you a nice glow. So yeah. Would you advise chemical peeling in lichen planus pigmentosus? If yes, which one? And also in seborrheic melanosis? Yeah, definitely we can do in lichen planus, you know, pigmentosis. A TCA would be great. You know, it works very well. So definitely you can try the TCA and as well as the seborrheic melanosis. What more good type brand name of types of peels? So different areas, different countries have different kinds of peels. So I would really not be able to comment on that. Like in the UAE, we have a lot of chemical peels available in different concentrations. We have it from all over the world. We have some Spanish peels, some Italian, some from the US. So, like, you know, you have to do a thorough research of the market, read the reviews online, you know, always trust products which are safe and from reputed brands, you know. That's my advice. Yes, this course basically, as in recognized, as in the IMA basically conducts the laser courses every month, and we also have, which are recognized with the Dubai Health Authority, and also it makes it eligible for you to get the laser license. Chemical peels and mesotherapy are adjunct courses, so of course they are recognized by the Dubai Healthcare City. Yes. Can we use peel after laser session the same day? No, I would not advise this, Shahid, because, you know, your skin is undergone a shaving and then the laser session and then the peel. So it's going to be kind of very aggressive. I would not advise it unless it's a very, very, very less concentration of alpha hydroxy acid. I would not advise you to do the peel. Just wait for a couple of days prior to the peel. Kindly give detail account. How can we do procedure with chemical peeling along with different energy devices? So basically, you can do chemical peel and energy-based devices in the same session at the same time, depending on what energy-based devices you're using. Like, for example, if you're using an IPL, okay, you know, just for rejuvenation, after your couple of shots of IPL, you can do your mild TCA, like, you know, 7.5% or 10% at the same time. That's not a problem. As long as you're not doing resurfacing. Can we apply peels on patients taking oral or IV chemotherapeutic drugs? No, I would not apply peels for patients on chemotherapy, definitely. Around 3 until 6 minutes. So are you talking about glycolic acid? If you're talking about glycolic acid, see, if it's a very buffered solution, then it's no point only doing it. It's going to be like neutralizing itself. So if normally glycolic acid, 3 to 5 minutes. I'm going to share a big office. How do I send you? What is the best treatment for syringoma? Syringoma, you need to electroquaterize it, burn it basically. You can't do it with peels. Thank you so much, Ms. Basmira. How many minutes can we leave the salicylic acid peel? Salicylic acid anywhere between 3 to 5 minutes. You will see the frosting, you know, you will see that the salicylic acid crystals have settled down, and then you can probably just clean it up with water. Otherwise, it just looks a little bit weird, because but salicylic acid is self-neutralizing, so it's completely fine to even just leave it, put a moisturizer and sunblock. Is acetone not dangerous? No. How frequently can we do a peel? Sana, we can do a peel every 2 weeks, depending on the condition, like, and what kind of concentration you're using. So you can do it every 2 weeks, basically. 2 to 3 weeks. But you have to be careful. Like, if you've done one peel and then you have, you know, the patient comes to you after 2 weeks and sees she's still peeling, definitely I would not do the peel. Then you'll wait for another week or so and give her some moisturizing agents by then. what treatment can we do for the patients with big blood boils on both cheeks? Or if it's like acne grade 3, definitely you require, oral antibiotics. And then you can do salicylic acid. Salicylic acid works really well. Azelaic acid, salicylic acid works very well for active acne. Acetone basically is used for degreasing the skin, removing the grease in the skin so that the peel penetrates better. Treatment for glycolic acid peels. Yeah, same. The priming remains the same. Sunscreen 2 to 3 weeks prior, and definitely you will continue forever. And you can use any kind of alpha hydroxy acids, like, you know, most of the creams, very, very less concentration of alpha hydroxy acid, like lactic acid, glycolic acid can be used, or hydroquinone can be used as a priming agent, or just basic retinol can be used as well. What's the best chemical peel for freckles? For freckles, you can definitely try TCA. It really works. And, you know, lesser concentrations and then built up slowly, slowly. Can you send us more details about chemical peels online course? Definitely, we will send you, and also follow our Instagram page. And it's on our website, imadubai.com, where you can find all the information about our courses. From what age can we start chemical peel? Chemical peel doesn't have any age. Like, you know, if a teenager has acne problems, 12, 13 years, you can safely do a chemical peel. What is the best peel for PIH after erbium laser? Definitely, you can do basically any kind of peel. Like, you know, you can do a Jessner's, you can do a TCA. You can also just keep the patient on a Dermamilan or Dermamilan home care or Dermamilan peel, which will help for, lightening the PIH. And remember, always PIH post lasers is transient. But, you know, depending on the skin type, it might take a month, 2 months, 3 months, 6 months. So just to fasten the procedure, you can use these peels, or just give them home care, or just hydroquinone, Kligman's formula would also work well, and do the chemical peels at the clinic as well. So it's good. Can we use glycolic 20%? Yes, you can use, but with caution, because the patient is on Roaccutane, so you have to be careful, because the skin is very, very dry. Skin is very, very dehydrated, so you have to be really careful. Role of tranexamic acid, we spoke about. Which peel is the most suitable for hyperpigmentation? A lot of chemical peels, actually. You can use single acid peels like TCA, starting from the lowest concentration and building up. Then you have the combination peels like Dermamilan, Cosmilan, Perfect Peel. You have the yellow peel, you have the green peel. There are a lot of peels. And can we do microdermabrasion as priming prior to the... Yes, definitely. But acne, I would not prefer prior to acne peel acetic acid. Microdermabrasion, I would not prefer doing for an acne patient in the first and foremost, because it might abrade and, you know, make it worse. So, you know, I would not do. Very gentle, if you want to do, you can do, but not on the same day as the peel. So you'll do a couple of days before the peel, and then you can do the peel. Yes, you can do that. We use chemical peels for acne scars, not for acne. For Cosmilan peel, we can do it once in 6 months safely. That there's no harm, and keep them on the home care. How can I use purple peel? I don't have any idea about which purple peel actually, so I cannot comment on that. Eye area, you can do a lot of peels for the eye area, like lactic acid peels, kojic acid. They're very, very safe. Glycolic acid also in a lesser percentage. TCA also in a lesser percentage can be used around the eyes safely. We use chemical peels for acne scars, not for acne, right? Yes, yes, yes. We do not use it for acne scars. You know, acne scars, I'm talking about the atrophic scars, which are deep. So as you know, it cannot penetrate, because in our normal day-to-day practice, we are not even using medium depth. We're using maximum, very superficial and superficial peels. So acne scars are very, very deep, you know. So our peels would not penetrate there, and hence we will not get the desired results. So that's why we cannot use peels for acne scars. Then, Can we apply peels on patient on oral antibiotics? Yes, you can use it if they are on doxycycline or tetracyclines. For skin type 4/5/6, what is the ideal peel? You can use all peels on 4/5/6, but it's just that you have to be very careful with these skin types. You have to be sticking to the protocol. You do not be over enthusiastic and keep it for a long time and apply more coats than required. So you can use all peels safely. Contact time differs for different skin types. Dark circle areas, we discussed lactic acid. Thank you so much, everyone. I'm glad you enjoyed, gained some knowledge and enjoyed the presentation. I tried to make it as interesting as possible. Glycolic acid, you can do on a patient with Roaccutane, no problem, but you have to be careful. Cosmolan peel can be used every 6 months. Can we combine plasma lifting and peeling together? No. Carbon peel is done with a laser, with the Q-switched NDI laser, and you apply basically a thin layer of carbon particles, which increases the absorption, and that's about, yeah. Yeah, lichen planus pigmentosus, you can use glycolic acid, you can use trichloroacetic acid, anything which is a tyrosinase inhibitor. We can use energy-based devices like IPL or Q-switched NDI, non-ablative basically, and then we can do the peels as well. Oh, thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for your support, and we look forward to having you in the following. I mean, we might have more webinars in the future, so do attend the webinars. And it was great having you. I try to answer maximum questions as as much as possible, and I think we will be sending you the recording soon. So thank you very much for your patience and support, and do visit our Instagram page of IMA Dubai. So you'll be, I mean, you can keep in touch with us and also see the upcoming activities. Thank you very much. Have a good evening.